So welcome everybody, and thanks for taking the time to participate in Danfoss Cooling United live event. Today I'd like to talk to you about EXVs, or electric expansion valves. My name is Vic Marinich, and I'm part of the global segment marketing team here at Danfoss. So maybe the first thing to answer, of course, is why do we even need an EXV? There's other products out there, mechanical valves, fixed orifice, and so on that we can use. So there's a couple main things that the EXVs bring to the table that I think are very important. First off, we're talking efficiency. Everybody today is redesigning units to get higher and higher efficiency. We know regulations are driving efficiency higher as well. The EXV, because it's a motorized valve, you're going to get very precise flow of the refrigerant, very good control on the refrigerant, and so we're going to be able to maintain a very stable superheat. And if you can maintain a stable superheat, you can run it as low as possible with that superheat, thus giving you the best usage of your evaporator without sending liquid into your compressor and getting the best efficiency out of the system. One of the other key points with the EXV is its ability to work in very low charge systems. These next generation refrigerants are oftentimes anyway mildly flammable, and they're also rather expensive. So everyone is doing what they can to reduce system charge, like going to microchannel heat exchangers, brazed plate heat exchangers, and so on. When you've got much lower capacity, much lower refrigerant in the system, every little change in the system is going to react very quickly and very suddenly. So you need a valve like an EXV that can match that quick reaction time to make sure that you get good stable control of your system. Finally, the EXV has a very wide operating range. So if you're looking at a more industrial process where you're going to be running in lower ambient conditions, then that low delta P across the valve with other technologies is going to be very hard to control. But with the EXV, because it's driven with a motor, you can still control your superheat very well with low delta Ps. So why don't we take a look at some of the products that Danfoss offers when it comes to our electric expansion valves. So we start with our newest member of the family, and this is the Danfoss ETS 5M. So it's a small electric expansion valve, good up to about 5.5 tons or about 20 kilowatts. It's designed for use primarily with the high density, call them 410A like refrigerants. So it works obviously with 410A, but then also with the next generation refrigerants. So R32, R454B, R452B. It's obviously a small compact valve, so it works very well in like an indoor VRF unit, and it's also very quiet. And when we say quiet, I mean the coil itself is quiet, so you don't hear mechanical clicking, but then it's also designed to minimize the noise of the gas flow through the valve. So having a unit indoors, you don't have noise issues. Also works very well in residential heat pumps and computer room air conditioning units. So our next valve is our ETSC Colibri. And you can see it's a very unique looking valve, an all stainless steel valve here. The capacity range on this valve runs from about 12 to 140 tons, which is about 40 to 500 kilowatts. This valve works with both a high and medium density refrigerants. So for the high density refrigerants, 410A and its replacements, the A2Ls, R32, 454B, 452B, but also with R134A and its replacements, so like R1234ZE. And that's important because you can imagine when we look at this capacity range, 12 through 140 tons, you know, 40 through 500 kilowatts, we kind of are straddling scroll applications up into screw applications for the chillers. So we want to make sure that, you know, we've got a valve that's going to cover both of your needs, whether it's a high pressure, high density scroll system or a medium density screw system. So this valve will cover both of those applications. It's a very fast opening and closing valve. It'll go from fully open to fully closed in about 6 seconds. And so that means when you do shut it down, you're going to minimize the refrigerant coming back into your compressor to make sure you're protecting the compressor. Now, something that both of these valves have in common is they're also 100% hermetically sealed. You can see fully welded, no threaded connections on either of these valves. That's important because we realize going forward, most of the refrigerant alternatives are going to be flammable or mildly flammable. So we want to make sure that we have a fully sealed valve so we reduce the leak potential coming through either one of those valves. And then finally, we have the biggest valves in our family, and you can see here this is our ETS 800P. So you can see it's a manifolded solution. It consists of two valves, both ETS 400, and we also have a ETS 200. So the full range will run from 200 tons up through 800 tons, or up to about 2,800 kilowatts. When it's put in this manifold setup, you can see both motors are still independent, but they'll run at the same time, at the same speed. So actually both leads will just go back to one controller and you open and close the valves in parallel. So you may ask, why such a big valve, 800 tons? What we're seeing in the market, again, because efficiency is becoming so important, that systems today that maybe weren't using expansion devices at all, or maybe we're using a butterfly valve, or maybe a even a fixed orifice, are looking to increase their system efficiencies and going to an EXV. So we've made this going up to 800 tons for centrifugal chillers and maybe even some other systems that are looking for expansion devices. And something else that all three of these valves have in common that's very important is they all have been designed, tested, and qualified to work in oil-free environments. So if you're looking to design a system with a turbo core compressor, we know that it's a centrifugal oil-free compressor that Danfoss manufactures. You want to make sure your components have also been tested and qualified to work that way. A lot of the components today that you'll see will be tested in dry air, which you can say, okay, there's no oil in it. It's the air that they test instead of refrigerants. But it's very important to make sure you're actually testing this with the dry refrigerant in the system for the lifetime of the valve. The refrigerant acts as a detergent, and so there may be some grease on these valves from the manufacturing processes. And if you're running refrigerant through here, you're going to wipe all that grease off of all the components in here and then really give these valves a test when it comes to an oil-free system. I can tell you, just because it works in dry air doesn't mean it's going to work in an oil-free refrigerant system. So you can see at Danfoss, we cover our full range from 5.5 tons with our ETS 5M up through 800 tons on our ETS 800P. But as we said in the beginning, these are electric valves. They're all stepper motor driven. So we need a way to turn the motor. And of course, we need a way to know when that motor needs to get turned. And to do that, we have a few solutions here. So this here is our EKE Superheat Controller. We have several different versions. This happens to be our 1C version. The versions differ depending on what kind of communication you want with the controller, on the different inputs and outputs you have, and so on. So we have multiple versions to make sure that you have exactly the right superheat controller to match your system design. So what will happen is you'll get a pressure and temperature input coming from just after the evaporator, and the controller will calculate the superheat based on the calculated superheat, and then what it sees as the optimum superheat will then tell any of these valves to open or close. So that way we're maintaining the correct superheat from the system. All of the controllers come with the Danfoss MSS, or minimum stable superheat algorithms, on them. And what they are is learning algorithms that are going to be running as the system keeps running and learning, so that we are always running at the lowest possible superheat, not at a fixed superheat point. So for example, you can buy a thermostatic valve, put it in, set it to run at, let's say, 8 degrees K superheat, and that's what it'll run no matter what. With an electric valve, you're going to have it running at the proper superheat to make sure you optimize efficiency while also protecting the compressor. So it could go down to 4 degrees, could be up to 12 degrees, whatever it is that it needs to protect the compressor and to give you the best efficiency in your system. So we have the electric sensor, or the electric controller. And as I mentioned, you need sensors coming in here to be able to control the valve. So we have a few sensors. First, we have temperature sensors, and we have many, many different types of temperature sensors, different technologies, again, depending on your specific application. We have a P1000, we have NTC, different wire lengths, different sizes of the element itself, and so on, again, depending where you're installing it and so on. But then we also have a pressure sensor. And this is also a new product to Danfoss. So this is our DST P110 pressure sensor. And it also comes with some different options, different wire options, different mechanical connections. But this sensor is a smart sensor, so it has some self-diagnostics in it. So we know that it's running properly when it's installed in the system. But also, when we developed the sensor, we also developed our calibration and testing technologies and had them so accurate that now we can actually calibrate and test these valves in many instances, so that this sensor is used both on your high side and your low side, and you'll still maintain the error bands that you need to have a good control of your system. We know today, typically, you'll buy one pressure sensor on the low side, very similar looking one, different model number that you use on the high side. So you've got two times the inventory and, of course, the potential to get them mixed up. With this sensor, there's a good opportunity that you can use that same sensor on both the high and the low side. So we're protecting from pressure, and then we've got our final product here, which is the Danfoss EKE2U power backup module. And this, again, is meant to protect your system in the event of a power failure. So if you have, let's say, a chiller running in your building, the whole building loses power, your chiller loses power, what happens? This valve, if it was halfway open, will still stay halfway open. And all that refrigerant that's in the system will ultimately migrate its way through the valve to the coldest point, into the evaporator, into the sump of your compressor, right? We know that's not good, right? We want to keep the refrigerant out of the compressor because at startup, we risk damaging or even destroying the compressor. So the EKE2U power supply will sense the loss of power, and it's made with a bunch of ultra caps inside that are all charged while the chiller's running. And it'll send, once it gets a signal that power's lost, it will send a signal to the EKE superheat controller and tell it to drive the valve shut. So that way, as soon as you lose power, you automatically drive the valve shut, and we're protecting your compressor and the rest of the system. There's a few other ways that this is done. We know you can put a solenoid valve in ahead of time so that when it loses power, the solenoid closes. That's a bit expensive. You're adding two more braze joints to the system. You're reducing the KV value, so you're adding more pressure drop, so not a great solution. And there's also battery backups, but batteries we know have to be constantly recharged. And if they go bad, you're going to find out only when you lose system power, and that's the wrong time to find out that, oh, I should have changed the batteries out. The ultra capacitors will stay charged throughout. It also has a state of health monitor on it. So if there is an issue with the capacitors themselves, if they're draining too quickly or some other issue, you'll get a signal flashing here, but you'll also get a signal sent back to your unit controller to let you know that there's a problem. And so you can react to the issue before you have a problem with shutdown, and you can replace the capacitors. So I hope you can see that Danfoss, we have a full line of electric expansion valves to meet your design needs, regardless of the application you're looking at. And we also have all the components that you need to support a safe and long running life on those valves and on your systems. So I want to thank you for joining us today, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your time at Danfoss Cooling United. Thanks.